YouTube. This is Michigan Snow Pony Renee. Like you've never seen me. Yesterday was our 20th or 28th wedding anniversary, and I got a black eye. No, Tim didn't do it. He wouldn't be alive if he did. But I walked into a machine at work. I did this at work. I'm a klutz. I was looking at a clipboard, walking through an x-ray room, and the overhead was in the middle of the room instead of over the table like they usually are, and I clunked right into it. And I'm so hard-headed, I didn't even see stars. So it'll go away. It looks worse than it is. There, we got that out of the way. I begged off going to church this morning because I didn't want everybody coming up and saying, what happened, you know. I just hate attention. That's why I have a YouTube channel. Anyway, let's get to the questions. I hope the wind isn't going to create too much noise. Julia writes, what do you feed your pee-pee pigs? I just got two, and I don't want to kill the poor things. At what age do you process your potbelly pigs? Julia, I don't have potbelly pigs. Mine are cooney-cooney pigs. I have no experience with potbelly pigs. I don't know if you feed them differently, and I don't know when you process them. This brings up a really good point. Before you bring any animal home, do a little research. Know what you're getting into. That'll be better for you and the animals. And then you won't be scrambling around afterwards like, oh my gosh, what have I done? And I know those opportunities come up. You see, you know, a free animal that you want to incorporate into your homestead, and maybe it's a little earlier than what you wanted to do it, or a friend gives you some free critters that you want that maybe you're not prepared for at that point. So I know those things happen. You know, I had chicks in my bathtub at one point early on. But try to do a little research, and I'm sure there's lots of information on the internet about what to feed pot-bellied pigs and when to butcher them. Although you may have to go outside this country to find out about the butchering information, because not too many people eat them, I don't think. They keep them as pets. But anyway, good luck. Mindy writes, I homeschool and would like to know, is the Robinson curriculum still working for your girls? I'm seriously thinking about switching to it and would like your review. Yeah, we're going to stick with it. The Robinson curriculum is basically literature or English and vocabulary and Saxon math. That's the Robinson curriculum. There's nothing else to it. All the books that are incorporated into it are, I think, written before 1930 or 1940. They're the old classic Jules Verne, Samuel Clemens, autobiographies by famous figures in history, that kind of thing. And we really like them. But if you want to expand your child's curriculum, you're going to have to go outside the Robinson because there's nothing else. I really like Saxon math. My girls are excelling in it. They went through a whole book and a half last year, so they're both now working well above their grade level at this point. And Charlotte was a surprise. We knew Lena was advanced. We didn't know Charlotte was till we figured out that she didn't want to be a nerd, so she just kind of stayed in the middle of the pack. And now that there's not peers around, now she's going at her pace. Little stinker. She knew her sister was a nerd and she didn't want to be. Anyway, this fall I am putting the girls into a one-day school for homeschooled kids, and it's called Friday Editions. And they get math, or not math, they get gym, Spanish, art, music, karate. There's one other one. And it's an all-day program on Fridays. And I think, and also it's going to be for socialization, meeting other kids. So I think that's going to round them out really well. But yeah, we're sticking with Robinson. The philosophy is that first you start with the basics, reading well, being well read, having a good vocabulary, and knowing how to do basic math skills, and then everything else will fall into place as they mature. And I tend to believe that is a good philosophy. I think a lot of what's taught in public school is fluff, and getting to be more and more political fluff, if you will. But anyway, I don't want to go off on a soapbox here. So yeah, we're sticking with it. It's not for everybody. The emphasis is on being self-taught and going at their own pace. I like that, because once you get the skills to teach yourself things, the world's open to you. So I like that philosophy, but some people won't. Anyway, next question. Lola. Let's see. Brenda writes, I've said in the past that I want your life. Really? You want to be a klutz? I've done the children part, now I'm ready for the homestead part. My husband and I are in our mid-50s. Yikes. Don't say yikes about being mid-50s. I'm mid-50s. Come on. You know, it's the new 30. Oh, I meant to get a prop. I'll be right back.
Okay, Brenda, you're going to want to get this book, 5 Acres
and a Dream, the book. There's also a blog site by the same name. The gal that wrote it is in her 50s, empty nester. It's going to be a very similar situation to what you're talking about, and I think you'll get a lot out of the book. I also had her on the Homestead Honey Hour. If you go to prepperbroadcasting.net, you can find that in the archives. So check out that book. It'll resonate with you, I'm sure. Anyway, we live in horrid California and plan on moving out of state when we retire. My husband's major concern is cost. I'm just going to kind of cut down here. We grow a decent amount of produce on our little lot and have no livestock. How do we figure out how expensive the animal portion of the living expenses will be? Well, you just have to keep track, and I don't. you write down your feed and then how much or how long it lasts you, and that gives you approximation of what the animals cost, and then you figure in, like, if they're chickens and they're laying eggs, you know, how many eggs you get and, you know, what those eggs cost you per dozen. That's, you know, you actually have to kind of be in the situation to figure it out ahead of time, unless you talk to a lot of people that do keep track. I'm not one. Let's see. We figure on paying cash for the house and land, but we'll have little income if we both quit and don't find new jobs. Way too much iffiness going on here. Yeah, I hear ya. Is it expensive to raise chicken, goats, and pigs, or do they usually make money? I know there are way too many variables, so let's just ask. Do your animals cost you, or do they improve your bottom line? With the price of eggs, I used to say they cost me, but now I'm not so sure. And also, you have to factor in what you're getting at the grocery store cheap. You know, yeah, you can get eggs for, what, $1 a dozen sometimes, but they're the factory farm eggs, and there's no comparison to what you're going to get off the farm. So those eggs go for, and they're not even comparable, those eggs go for what, $4.50 a dozen? So make sure that when you're doing your factoring, you're doing apples to apples, not apples to oranges. And as far as the goats, well, that depends on if you have land to graze them or if you have to buy all your feed. Again, I like the product I get from my goats better than I do what's available in the store. And I live in a state that's, you can get shares of dairy animals, but I just don't want to jump through those hoops. So I'm going to have my own goats. Pigs can be very economical to raise because they're omnivores, they'll eat anything. And if you can work out a deal with like a small grocer, his spent produce in that, or a day-old bakeries by you, you can get old bakery products. That's a cheap way to feed them. Just your lawn clippings and weeds out of your garden, they'll eat those. So, you know, it depends on how frugal you are and what your land is like as to what it lends up that you can feed. Free-range chickens cost basically hardly anything to feed in the summer months. Well, unless you're somewhere where it's summer all the time, like California. Chickens pretty much take care of themselves in the summer. If they can get bugs and greens, you'll go through very little feed. So they're very economical to keep. And that's a good livestock to break into. So I'm sorry I can't be more helpful, but for me, the bottom line is the product I get and knowing where it came from and how it was raised versus the cost. But I'll tell you, after going to the grocery store, that line is probably going to get crossed here pretty soon, where it is going to be more economical to raise your own. I think we're headed that way quickly.
Kathleen writes,
in your volunteer potato video, I noticed next to the potatoes growing in your yard, there was milkweed. Let's see. Do you have any way of getting rid of milkweed if you're familiar with it? Yeah, pulling it. you can use Roundup. That will kill it. But I just pull it out. It's not a big concern. And if you do a little research, you'll find out that the monarch butterflies are kind of in distress right now, and that's their primary food source. So even though milkweed is poisonous, most animals will not eat it. My horses are out in the pasture. There's milkweed out there. There's enough else for them to eat. They never touch it. And same with goats. It is poisonous, and it is unsightly, and it can take over. But I don't think it's that big of a deal. And you're going to help the monarchs if you let some of it go. So it's not something I really worry. I pull it out of the garden. It sends kind of like runners underground. So you'll see ones pop up and they pull out really easy. But then two more will pop up in its place. But you just stay ahead of it. And I don't find it a big nuisance.
Kim writes, oh, this wind is blowing my paper. I see that you have put straw around your garden plants to prevent weeds. How are you liking that?
It's the best I can do. Ideally, I do the back to Eden method and have wood chips. That's what I'd love to do, but I can't find free wood chips, and my garden is too big to try to buy wood chips to put it 4 or 6 inches deep out there. So the compressed straw bales that are chopped and they have guar gum in them so they stay put, don't blow around, that's my best bet. It cost me about $220 to do that garden in the straw. And I know you asked further down in your question if we just till it in or if we rake it off. It's pretty much spent by the end of the season, so it's really no big deal to till it in or just leave it there. It breaks down pretty fast. Now, I've tried regular old straw bales, and then I had, it was either wheat or oats, I can't remember, but sprouting all over the garden. So I like this chopped straw. It's easier to spread out evenly, and with the guar gum in it, which is a natural thickening agent, it stays put. So I do like it. It's not ideal. It helps somewhat with the weeds. It doesn't prevent the weeds, but it does cut down on them. And it does, I think, helps hold in the moisture somewhat as well. Not as well as wood chips, but I'm doing the best I can with what I got to work with. So yeah, I'm going to continue to use that unless I get some free source of wood chips at some point. Not holding my breath. Writing. I was thinking of making instant mashed potatoes by boiling, ricing, then dehydrating fresh potatoes. I was wondering what you thought of the idea. I'm going to give it a try, but in hindsight, I'm wondering if upon rehydrating, it will turn into potato slime or paste. What do you think? I've never tried that. My guess is that it would not be the right consistency. but it doesn't hurt to try something. I could be dead wrong. But my gut tells me that's what you'd have too. It's kind of slimy potatoes, not mashed potatoes. But, you know, give it a try and put up a video if it works, you know. She also writes, what are your favorite things to dehydrate and why? I like to dehydrate citrus fruit because I like to stick it in tea. I love to dehydrate mushrooms. I use them in everything. I know you wrote that you also did mushrooms, but you had trouble getting them to a nice consistency. They were chewy, even after being in a dish. I tend to use them in things like casseroles or crock pot things where they're going to cook a long time, and I have not noticed that. We also like to eat them as chips. Mine are crunchy. And I don't think it goes by how, well, you want to slice them fairly thin, but we like to eat them like potato chips. So I just love having dehydrated mushrooms on hand. They're my favorite thing. I also like to dehydrate fruit because I like to put that in yogurt. We like custard thick style yogurt. And if you put fresh fruit, it tends to make it runnier. But if you put the dried fruit, it absorbs the moisture. And that even makes it more custardy. So anyway, those are my favorite things to dehydrate. I like to make beef jerky too, but beef's been too expensive to do. So my family's all whining. Jesse also writes, I'd like to try water bath canning some fruits this summer, like peaches. Do you know if there's an alternative to simple syrup? I'd like to keep the fruit low calorie and natural. Oh yeah, you do not have to use a sugar syrup. You can use plain old water or natural fruit juice. There's going to be a few things you want to keep in mind, though, if you go that route. Contrary to popular belief, the sugar syrup does not help preserve the fruit. It doesn't. What it does do, however, is it usually helps make the fruit look nicer, longer. So if you're going to use fruit juice or especially water, you're going to want to treat your fruit before you put it in the jars with like something that's got vitamin C or ascorbic acid, like fruit fresh or something like that. And that will help. And also you're going to want to pick fruit that's like perfectly ripe as best you can. That will help too. You're going to use the hot pack method. And yeah, just make sure the fruit is covered with the liquid. And you can use plain water or fruit juice. A lot of people do that. Diabetics do that. And by the same token, if you guys are canning vegetables or meat, you don't need to add salt. lots of people say it helps preserve it, but you know what? It'll keep just fine without salt. Because I've forgotten before, and I haven't noticed any difference other than the flavor's a little bland. But so yeah, Angie writes, just watched your 2013 video about dehydrated blueberries. How have they turned out as you've used them as recipes? Like I mentioned, I use dried fruit in yogurt that I make, and I've also put them in muffins. But I rehydrate them first. I let them soak in some hot water for about half an hour before I do that, and they're fine. They do just great. Those are about the only two things I use them for, because I also can pie fillings up, so I don't tend to use my dehydrated fruit for pies and things. I just don't, because I have the pie filling. She does ask, however, about my papers blew away. She asked about my recipe for blueberry pie filling, and it's from this book, The Complete Book of Home Preserving by Ball. Everybody has the little blue book that's thin. This is the big one. This is the mother book. And this has all your pie filling recipes. And on page 171, see? Fruit pie fillings. But on 171, there is blueberry pie filling. And I'll just read it to you. Well, I'll send it to you. I will send it to you in an email. Hopefully I won't forget. You might have to nag me. Oh, that extreme close-up of it. Sorry. Anyway, that's all our questions today. Thanks. Remember, send them at michigansnowpony@gmail.com if you have a question, and I'll get to them as soon as I can. Hi YouTube. Today on our makeup tutorial, we're going to be doing zombie smoky eye. Lots and lots of black and blue eyeshadow. I'm so excited.
What you looking at? You want a piece of me? See what the other three guys look like.